Current tension could lead to war in the Korean Peninsula, a war which could spread to all of Asia and then to a worldwide conflict.
Our mission is a swift and crushing reaction to any North Korean attack. If they dare to attack, we will send them to their graves.
This is the last border of the Cold War. A front line with an ongoing face-to-face since 1953, the separation of the two Koreas. But since 2008, tension has never been so high, since Kim Jong-il's poor health has shaken up the dictatorship of Pyongyang. In the wings of the most secretive regime of the planet, a war of succession is raging, a fight for the control of his giant army.
We are heading towards a catastrophe because of concerted actions against our republic. We are faced with intransigent behavior. We are on the brink of war.
At the beginning of 2010, a North Korean torpedo attack sinks a southern warship. 46 sailors are killed. Since then, hundreds of thousands of men and machines have been assembled on land and at sea, awaiting feverishly a sign from the dictator. In Pyongyang, he is attempting to impose one of his sons as heir. A war of succession which could get out of hand. His last days in power will determine peace or war in all of Asia. We're in late summer of 2010 in the north of China, previously Korean territory. This is where Kim Jong-il has chosen to take what is presumably his last trip. The Chinese officials show him around factories and farms. The dictator seems tired, sometimes moving with difficulty.
He had one, perhaps two strokes in August of 2008. So clearly his health was impacted. Everyone continues to follow every picture that's released to see whether his left side especially is suffering from the after effects of a stroke. He has diabetes, he has other health problems, so if you just sort of use insurance actuarial tables, he's probably not going to last more than 5 years, if that. So there's overlaid over the typical concerns, fears, nervousness about North Korean intentions, you have underlying that now the uncertainty of how the succession will play out. Whether it will, the power will successfully devolve to his third son, Kim Jong-un, or whether there would be a challenge to the planned succession.
This journey has the sole purpose of delving into his father's past, who was once a schoolboy in the city of Jilin. Kim Il-sung, the living god of North Korea, the country's creator. He came into power at the end of World War II and for 40 years established a regime unique in its kind. He is the only communist dictator in the world to have handed over the power to his own son, Kim Jong-il. A son who now knows his days are numbered and that it is his turn to hand over the reins. His youngest son, Kim Jong-un, accompanies him on this journey, an anonymous face among the surrounding officials. He is preparing him for his dynastic succession like his father before him.
One really cannot consider the personality of Kim Jong-il, a most unique leader, without putting it in the context of his charismatic father of his nation, Kim Il-sung. Kim Il-sung was a man of gigantic stature, a man of almost godlike proportions. He was the father of his nation. He was a guerrilla fighter. He created the ideology of North Korea, Juche, self-reliance. And all of these things, Kim Jong-il is not. Now, I see his whole life as being determined by this, for throughout his life he has been in the shadow of his father.
To establish a hereditary dynasty in North Korea, Kim Jong-il cultivated an unbelievable legend, one of a quasi-divine family whose powers crystallize in him. The lie begins at birth.
Kim Jong-il's leadership of Korea. Mount Baekdu, the mountain that shines with the history of the Korean Revolution, tells the great history of the leadership of Korea by Kim Jong-il, chairman of the National Defense Commission of the Democratic People's Republic of Korea and supreme commander of the Korean People's Army.
In this propaganda film, it is told that the dear leader was born February the 16th, 1942, on Mount Baekdu, a sacred mountain for the Koreans. A star and a double rainbow appeared to hail his coming. In fact, the young Kim Jong-il was born a year earlier in a Korean refugee camp in the Soviet Union, where his father was under protection and training as a guerrilla fighter.
Kim Jong-il keeps up this connection to the sacred mountain. He has his rice grown there, and every grain of rice is inspected to make sure it is perfect. He has water from springs on Mount Baekdu. So this is of huge importance, but in fact, it's a total fabrication.
The young Kim is three in 1945. He travels to Pyongyang with his parents and is housed in a large house assigned to his father, who is quickly rising to power. Beside this house, there is a pond where he often plays with his older brother, Kim Shura.
From two different defectors comes the story that they were swimming together and there was an accident and his younger brother drowned. In fact, they indicated he smiled as he was holding his younger brother's head under the water, and one of the defectors indicated he went glug, glug, glug. If so, that's quite a psychological burden.
The following year is also traumatic. While his father takes power in Pyongyang, his mother dies giving birth to a stillborn baby. Kim Jong-il is only seven.
He never had a real mother, so no one really took care of him. That's how he grew up, out of control with no one to draw the line.
Once he reaches the age to begin his studies, Kim Jong-il attends the School for Children of Party Deputies, then the University of Pyongyang, already named after his father. This marks the beginning of the legend. The Kim Il-sung University religiously keeps the relics of his passage. While his father finds his legitimacy with his role in the guerrilla, Kim Jong-il finds his own credo here. Faced with professors who don't dare criticize the leader's son, he becomes a universal genius. A genius who will rapidly move closer to power.
His credentials are quite remarkable. He's a virtuoso violinist and piano player. By the way, as a golfer, he is reported to have three or four holes in one on every round he plays. It's really, he obviously would easily defeat Tiger Woods. Everything about him is magnified to such a ludicrous proportion. It's very first important position was, as Minister of Propaganda and Agitation, responsible for public relations about his father. So he not only created this godlike persona of his father, but it was he who was responsible for orchestrating the campaign that he was his father's son, and for attempting to pass on the charismatic hold of his father to his son. Does he believe this? I have the sense that as he was giving voice to these sentiments, of course he knew they were exaggerations, but repeat them enough, often enough, and it becomes truth, not just for his people, but for him as well.
Kim Jong-il is now in his 20s. From now on, he will be constantly in his father's wake. He perfects the propaganda system by wielding total control.
After birth, the first words I learned were Mom and Dad. But I also learned to say, thank you, dear leader. That's the first sentence we utter. Whatever we do during the day, when we eat, we must say, thank you, dear leader. In all the houses, in the most prestigious place of the house, there is a portrait of the leaders, Kim Jong-il and Kim Il-sung. That's my first memory as a child. That goes for the public space as well. Their portraits are everywhere.
We are taught that Kim Jong-il is a perfect being. He is so intelligent. He's a humanist. In fact, he's a saint. A flawless being. That's what you learn as a child.
Among the instruments of propaganda, the young Kim Jong-il discovers a devouring passion, film. His first job on the film sets of Pyongyang is censorship. He then begins to write his own scripts, often stories of young girls devoting themselves to the homeland. And then he invites himself to the film shoots to direct the technical crew and the actors and the actresses. By the late 70s, he has boundless ambition for North Korean film, but is not satisfied with the artists he is directing. He hires a commando to kidnap one of the biggest South Korean stars and her husband, a film director, a star prisoner in the studios of Pyongyang.
Why did he kidnap us? We asked ourselves. Well, in fact, simply because he was a fan of our work. But not only of ours. He also has a huge collection of foreign films, tens of thousands. I think at least 15,000 films. Korea is very isolated, so I think he tries to understand other cultures through the films he watches.
For 8 years, these prisoners will rejuvenate the film industry. The first feature films, the first romantic films, the first on-screen kisses. Kim Jong-il even commissions the production of a memorable remake of Godzilla. A pawn of propaganda, the kidnapped film star works ceaselessly. Thank you. He orders North Korean diplomats on posting to collect thousands of films which he watches in his private viewing room. This is the young Kim's only window onto the world.
I've come to believe, and this isn't entirely tongue-in-cheek, that he models his way of being a leader on the basis of heroes in movies, like Shootout in the OK Corral or Shane, that he sees himself walking down the street against against the evil enemy and having this shootout. So there's this kind of larger-than-life way he parades on the world stage.
Through film, Kim Jong-il can approach the most beautiful women of his country. The short air with hang-ups is turning into a seducer.
The first time I met him, I was frightened and, of course, sad. Kim Jong-il appeared. He saw what state I was in and made a joke. Actress Choi, don't you think I look like a midget? Everyone laughed at this, and I relaxed, of course. That's his style. It means, yes, he is short, but that he takes into account the state of mind of the person standing before him.
In 1968, Song Yi-rim is one of the stars working for the Pyongyang studios. She has a degree in film, she is a talented and modern actress, a mother, and 4 years older than Kim Jong-il. She becomes the dictator's first mistress. Three years later, a son is born of this secret liaison. His name is Kim Jong-nam, a child who will have to grow up hiding the secrets of his origins.
Kim Jong-il met this actress, Song Hye-rim, and they moved in together. But she was already married and already had a little girl before meeting him. So he couldn't marry her. Kim Il-sung made Kim Jong-il marry a girl with a good background, Kim Yong-sok. The marriage was arranged for appearances.
There are no photographs of this official spouse who will give birth to two girls. She still lives in Pyongyang and often travels to Europe. Kim Jong-il's private life is never made public.
I never heard that Kim Jong-il was married. I remember when I was in university, I asked myself, why has our leader, now in his 50s, never married? Why doesn't he have any children? It bothered me, but I couldn't ask anyone. It's too dangerous to mention. My curiosity could bring death to myself and to my family for three generations.
In 1975, Kim Jong-il meets a young dancer of the entertainment group for officials. Her name is Ko Young-hee. She will become his official companion, always at his side, replacing the invisible wife. In the 80s, she will give the dictator two sons. Two sons who are now in the midst of a war of succession. Ko Young-hee died in 2004 in Paris, where many dignitaries of the regime come to be treated. The leader owns several residences to care for these different families. His official residence is in Pyongyang, close to Kim Il-sung Square. But on the coast and in the mountains close to the North Korean capital, he owns many houses. To feast them, he hires a Japanese chef. He organizes sumptuous receptions to which the party deputies are invited. He squanders his money.
An an interesting source of intelligence from the annual report of the Hennessy Fine Spirits Corporation. Their most expensive cognac is called Paradis. His annual bill for this cognac for the decade 1989 to 1999 was between $650,000 a year and $800,000 a year.
Kim Jong-il owns four companies of young girls, selected and trained solely to entertain the dictator during his evenings. A troupe for his personal pleasure. To become a member of this pleasure group, you must know how to sing, dance, and play music, and most of all, charm Kim Jong-il.
One evening, at the end of the meal, the general asked four of the girls to dance beside us. Suddenly he said, "Take off your costumes." They got undressed, keeping their bras and underwear. So he said, "Remove the bra and underwear." They were completely naked. Seeing this, I felt things were beginning to turn sour. He began picking out top executives, asking them to dance with them. One top executive, two, three, I'm the fourth. He points at me and says, "Dance." I didn't know where to look. They were completely naked. I looked at the ceiling while trying to disco dance. I did everything to avoid looking at those girls.
I was so nervous when I was invited to these evenings. I didn't know what to think. He's our great leader. I danced with him, dined with him. Being so close to him made me lose my bearings.
This is the life of a crown prince following in the footsteps of a father who is gradually letting him take up the reins of power. In 1994, Kim Il-sung is 84. With his son, he prepares a secret summit meeting with South Korea. But a few days before this would-be historic event, he collapses with a heart attack.
Kim Jong-il emerged as the effective next in line back in the 1970s. So there was a period of almost 20 years in which both the elites and the masses were prepared through propaganda campaigns for Kim Jong-il to take power. You know, shown with his father, doing things with his father, getting instructions from his father. Then, for the last 10 years of Kim Il-sung's life, Kim Jong-il effectively operated as the prime minister, running the government on a day-to-day basis.
After 3 years of national mourning, Kim Jong-il is confirmed as North Korea's new leader. He is not president, since this title is reserved eternally for his father. He's just dear leader, walking in his father's footsteps. But he's not as skillful in controlling the country's armed forces. Kim Il-sung's guerrilla comrades pin impressive medals on their uniforms. They consider that their comrade's son can't control everything by himself.
Kim Jong-il is the most important person in North Korea and has a great deal of power. However, he cannot take basic decisions on national security matters, on the nuclear negotiations, without consent of his top generals in the National Defense Commission. And so it's a complicated relationship. No outsider knows exactly how it is working. But there have been increasing indications in the past few years that the power of the hardline generals has grown.
For Kim Jong-il, in the face of these old generals, absolute power can be achieved through control of the army. He launches himself on an ongoing tour of all the military units of the country, along with continuous coverage by the state-controlled television. He now calls himself General. For the general, all the economic strife of the country is due to the enemies of the regime. This outside menace is the source of all problems. If North Koreans are famished, it's the fault of the rest of the world, and particularly the USA.
In reality, North Korea had already failed at the time of his father Kim Il-sung. It had failed economically and, to make things worse, found itself on the losing side of the Cold War, which means that at the end of the 80s, with the fall of the Berlin Wall, the countries of Eastern Europe gradually accepted capitalism, as did the communist regimes in Asia, like China. North Korea is the only regime who maintained the status quo.
Two years of floods give the death blow to a system on its last legs. At the end of the 90s, North Korea experiences one of the worst famines in history.
1 million, perhaps even 2 million people died, and yet there was no unrest against the government. There were no uprisings of significant size, and the regime didn't change its behavior. But also we've seen that the result of this malnutrition is that you have an entire generation that is smaller than its predecessor, and that when you compare North Koreans with South Koreans, they are significantly shorter, several inches shorter. And you have an entire generation that is not only physically stunted, but mentally stunted.
Paradoxically, this massive famine strengthens Kim Jong-il's power. The population is terrorized. When North Korea accepts a huge United Nations food aid program, the propaganda gives entire credit to the dear leader, to whom everyone now owes his life. Kim Jong-il reinforces his security and his control over his famished people. He has tunnels dug under the capital to protect his movements. He goes to Moscow and to Beijing to ask for help from his old allies. He fears so much for his life that he travels only by armored train.
The train is protected by rockets, heavy arms. The convoy is always composed of three identical trains, and nobody knows which one is occupied by Kim Jong-il. The passage of the train from the first to the last carriage can last for up to 3 hours. The water served on the train comes from a special source and arrives sealed. The food is also scanned by a special research body before being stowed aboard. Nobody can touch it.
The rare passengers describe sumptuous banquets and the performances of Kim Jong-il's pleasure group. But the dictator feels isolated in a changing world, a world that has become dangerous.
We were watching television via satellite. Ceausescu's final moments. We were in his residence on the coast. He was accompanied by 20 or 25 leaders. As he watched, the face of the general turned white. At the end of the show, all the leaders were looking at each other. He was quiet, and then he said, "We really need to think about the future of our country." He was completely white. It was a similar regime. The general must have imagined himself in Ceausescu's place. Later, he saw Saddam Hussein's statue knocked down. I was also with him on that day. Do you know what he said? Hussein is an idiot. That's all.
To avoid the same fate, Kim Jong-il tries to eliminate the threats. He considers the first on the list to be Washington. He makes it known that he is ready to negotiate with the USA and envisage a peace treaty which would at last end the Korean War. Since 1953, over 30,000 American soldiers are still stationed at the border of North Korea. To oblige Bill Clinton, he agrees to meet the South Korean president, Kim Dae-jung. It's the historic summit meeting between the two Koreas of June 2000. There are dreams of reunification.
Everyone always makes the comparison to Germany. And the situation on the Korean Peninsula is much, the stakes are much, much higher. First of all, West Germany was about twice as large as East Germany in population, or it was three times as large in population. In the case of the Koreas, South Korea is only twice as large. The income gap between the two Germanys was probably about half. In the case of North Korea, it's probably 15 or 20 times the income gap between South Korea and North Korea. The stakes are much higher than in the case of German unification.
While the world celebrates the renewal of ties between the two Koreas, Kim Jong-il is really pursuing a different objective than hypothetical reunification. His main goal is to humor Clinton.
One day he received a letter from Clinton. He was frightened by the United States of America, and he was so happy to receive this letter that he organized 3 days of festivities. Madeleine Albright brought the letter when she came to Pyongyang. He was so happy, he kept repeating, "I received a letter from Clinton. I received a letter from Clinton." He thought that he could maintain the regime by negotiating with the states. That was his sole purpose. He didn't want things to change.
To celebrate this budding reconciliation, Kim Jong-il drags the Secretary of State to one of the opening performances of Arirang, a show with no equivalent in the world, in the huge stadium of Pyongyang. It now takes place every year. 100,000 extras celebrate the regime and the ruling family. A month later, George Bush is elected President of the United States. The visit to Pyongyang is cancelled. The new president declares that Iraq, Iran and North Korea form the axis of evil that his administration must destroy. George Bush becomes the star of North Korean propaganda.
My first visit to North Korea in 2002, I met with Kim Jong-un, who was their lead nuclear negotiator, and he asked me three questions. One, why is George W. Bush so different from his father? Two, how do you function as a country when you elect people as president who have nothing in common with their predecessor? And then why don't you understand us better? All very good questions. And so there have been flip-flops in our policy, and they react to that. We never take blame for our own discontinuities, and I think that that has contributed to this whole process.
While the state wages war on Iraq, Kim Jong-il eagerly reinforces his military power. Military service for young Koreans lasts for over 10 years.
They have a million-man army. They have a great deal of quantity of weapons, but the quality is not good. It's outdated, and it's likely deteriorating. So, for example, their tanks. Their latest tank is a 1950s, 1960s era T-62 variant, which clearly could not stand up to the South Korean or U.S. tanks. Even a later generation tank called the T-72 that Iraq had was no match for U.S. and South Korean modern tanks. That said, they have thousands of them. So they have 13,000 or so artillery systems that could hit Seoul right now without even having to move forward. They have over 100,000 special forces. They have a very forward-deployed military. 60% or 70% of their military, of their entire military, is pre-deployed near the DMZ, within 60 or 70 miles. So they could inflict hundreds of thousands of casualties and great damage on South Korea.
If you look at North Korean per capita GDP, on size of economy, land mass, everything, you'll see that North Korean, the closest equivalent of North Korea is Mozambique. And who does care about Mozambique? Would you be sitting in my office? Have I been doing Mozambique? Probably not. So North Koreans understand that in order to be capable, to have influence, which in the final count, in order to extract aid from the outside world, they have to look dangerous. And in order to look dangerous, in order to be taken seriously, they could do nothing best, nothing better, but to develop nuclear weapons.
North Korea began thinking about nuclear weapons as early as the 50s. Today, it is the absolute priority. On October the 9th, 2006, the state television broadcaster had trouble controlling her emotions.
The people of North Korea have achieved a great scientific development, thanks to communism. Our scientists have successfully carried out a nuclear weapon explosion in an underground site on October the 9th. This scientific test brings new technology to our country. There has been no radiation contamination.
We know there is a nuclear weapons complex. We have some sense of some of the officials that are involved in it. But the safest answer is that Kim Jong-il is absolutely in charge of their nuclear weapons program. A good clue on that, for example, is that when the American delegation from the Clinton administration met with him and was interested in getting some information about some of their nuclear and missile programs, they presented him with a number of questions that they'd like answered. And he took the paper and read some of the questions and began answering them himself in great detail, in some technical detail. There's really no question that he is effectively the head of the nuclear program.
What they want most of all is full reconciliation with us so that they can be certain that we will not devastate them again as we did during the Korean War. And they also remember that Douglas MacArthur, the general, wanted to drop a necklace of nuclear weapons across the top of the Korean Peninsula. And they also have said to me in my five trips, we notice that you never attack anybody who has nuclear weapons. So that's why we've developed them.
may have as many as 8 or so nuclear weapons. We're not sure if all of them have been developed. North Korea claims they've weaponized all their plutonium. They are working on developing an intercontinental ballistic missile capability against the U.S. They've sent it downrange about 2,500 miles so far. U.S. intelligence community unclassified estimates are that within 10 years they could probably threaten all of the continental U.S. with a nuclear warhead. They already have 600 missiles that can already target all of South Korea, 300 missiles that can already target all of Japan. So, you know, their capability is declining in some aspects but increasing in others.
At the end of summer 2008, in the streets of Pyongyang, the clockwork lives of the inhabitants continue flawlessly. The secret is well kept. Kim Jong-il has disappeared. The regime dissembles. But Seoul and Beijing are worried. Nobody knows who is ruling North Korea.
To avoid a military coup, Kim Jong-il prohibits direct contact between the different factions of the army. Everyone must refer to Kim Jong-il, the only one with a global view. With this system, in the case of Kim Jong-il's sudden demise, there can be no coordination between the different military forces. This can lead to serious misunderstandings in the army. Just imagine one general being more ambitious than the others. This could create conflict, and they have weapons of mass destruction.
If the regime collapses, this could result in North Korean arms dealing outside of the country in terrorist networks and a massive exodus of refugees. They could go to China by crossing the border, or to South Korea via the Western Sea or the Eastern Sea. Can you imagine 10 million refugees landing in Seoul? It would be an economic disaster for South Korea.
French doctors are called to Pyongyang. Upon their return, they describe treating an anonymous patient, victim of a stroke. He will survive, but will be diminished. In the interim, Kim Jong-il's stepbrother takes over his responsibilities, a way for the family to maintain authority while filling the void of government, a 10-month-long void. In the spring of 2009, Kim Jong-il makes his comeback before a hysterical National Assembly. He is thin and pale, sometimes absent-looking. But he is alive.
But it is not clear that the elite themselves are all together. And once Kim Jong-il dies, it is quite possible that splits among the elite will emerge, and indeed these could actually turn into violent disputes.
Kim Jong-il knows he has to decide on his succession quickly. He has 3 sons and will have to select the one to appear at his side. Kim Jong-nam, his first son, born of a love affair with an actress, is not in the running. He lives on the fringe of the regime, between visits to Tokyo Disneyland and long nights spent in the casinos of Macau.
Are you Kim Jong-nam? Are you Kim Jong-nam? No.
Kim Jong-il had 2 other sons with Ko Yong-hee, his companion for 22 years. Jong-chul and Jong-un, born in the early 80s, are only in their 20s today. The dictator has sent them to a Swiss school in Bern. They speak German, English and a little French. They are pop music fans and attend concerts in Europe. They both love basketball and especially NBA, whose matches they follow on television.
As adolescents, the two brothers began to play more serious matches. They each had a team consisting of Kim Jong-il's star and would play small matches. At the end of each match, Jong-chul gathered his partners and thanked them each one by one. That's all. Jong-un, on the other hand, under the scrutiny of Kim Jong-il, his wife and other leaders, held a real meeting with his players. Your pass earlier was the pits. You shouldn't have sent the ball to him, but to him. He was in a position to score. He spoke to the players like that, despite the fact that they were all much older than he was. Kim Jong-il said to us, Jong-chul is not very good. He's too nice. He's like a girl. But Jong-un, I don't know why, but he's like me. By saying this, he was informing the leaders of his preference for his youngest. Among these people, there were also military leaders. He often repeated that he envisaged Jong-un as his successor.
The dictator has chosen Kim, third of the name, who will be called Jong-un. The propaganda gets on track progressively. The rise of a new sun in North Korea is announced. No images of the air filter, but he is already there, next to his father, and is beginning to collect official titles.
We have some evidence that a lot of North Koreans hadn't even heard of Kim Jong-un until the regime began promoting him in recent months. So they're going to be presented with this new leader, and their reaction's going to be, okay, you're telling me he's the son, but who is this guy? And in a Confucian society, he's very young. So there's a whole collection of factors that are going to be putting really unprecedented pressure on the ability of this regime to continue its self-justification.
This is Kim Jong-il's final challenge, to transmit some of his legitimacy to such a young son. On October the 10th, 2010, for the first time, he has him by his side in the official VIP stand for the most important military parade in the country's history. 100,000 men march past to officially celebrate the 65th anniversary of the Workers' Party. But the real issue is to celebrate the emergence of a new leader and make the first official image of Kim Jong-un a success.
During this transitional period, during the succession period, I think it makes complete sense that North Korea is going to be in a period where they are going to be seeking recurrent crises. They're going to be looking for that to keep their population in line, to remind them that they are a country under siege, which serves the interests of the regime, to create an atmosphere in which they will be asking their senior officials for loyalty.
It has artillery in place with a variety of missiles that could lay waste to at least the northern half of the city of Seoul and kill hundreds of thousands of people in the first 48 hours of a war. That they can do.
We're entering probably the greatest period of potential instability for North Korea since 1953, and that creates a situation where all this military capability, actually not only outside North Korea, but inside North Korea, is much more likely to be used than it ever has been.
For the time being, it is an armed ceasefire. On both sides of the border, the last Cold War hotspot, there is mutual observation. Since Since 1953, these hundreds of impenetrable wired-off kilometers separate North and South Korea. A strange balance hanging on the fate of one man, Kim Jong-il, who wants to impose a third generation of this unique dynastic dictatorship. At the boundary, people are ready to one day commit the barbed wire to memory, like the Berlin Wall, or to take up arms again if necessary. They never really drop them. Poor health has shaken up the dictatorship of Pyongyang. In the wings of the most secretive regime of the planet, a war of succession is raging, a fight for the control of his giant army.
We are heading towards a catastrophe because of concerted actions against our republic. We are faced with intransigent behavior. We are on the brink of war.
At the beginning of 2010, a North Korean torpedo attack sinks a southern warship. 46 sailors are killed. Since then, hundreds of thousands of men and machines have been assembled on land and at sea, awaiting feverishly a sign from the dictator. In Pyongyang, he is attempting to impose one of his sons as heir. A war of succession which could get out of hand. His last days in power will determine peace or war in all of Asia. A son who now knows his days are numbered and that it is his turn to hand over the reins. His youngest son, Kim Jong-un, accompanies him on this journey, an anonymous face among the surrounding officials. He is preparing him for his dynastic succession like his father before him.
One really cannot consider the personality of Kim Jong-il, a most unique leader, without putting it in the context of his charismatic father of his nation, Kim Il-sung. Kim Il-sung was a man of gigantic stature, a man of almost godlike proportions. He was the father of his nation. He was a guerrilla fighter. He created the ideology of North.
Current tension could lead to war in the Korean Peninsula, a war which could spread to all of Asia and then to a worldwide conflict.
Our mission is a swift and crushing reaction to any North Korean attack. If they dare to attack, we will send them to their graves.
This is the last border of the Cold War. A front line with an ongoing face-to-face since 1953, the separation of the two Koreas. But since 2008, tension has never been so high. Since Kim Jong-il's
past more than 5 years, if that. So there's, you know, overlaid over the typical concerns, fears, nervousness about North Korean intentions, you have, you know, underlying that now the uncertainty of how the succession will play out, whether it will, the power will successfully devolve to his third son, Kim Jong-un, or whether there would be a challenge to the planned succession.
This journey has the sole purpose of delving into his father's past, who was once a schoolboy in the city of Jilin. Kim Il-sung, the living god of North Korea, the country's creator. He came into power at the end of World War II and for 40 years established a regime unique in its kind. He is the only communist dictator in the world to have handed over the power to his own son, Kim Jong-il. We're in late summer of 2010 in the north of China, previously Korean territory. This is where Kim Jong-il has chosen to take what is presumably his last trip. The Chinese officials show him around factories and farms. The dictator seems tired, sometimes moving with difficulty.
He had one, perhaps two strokes in August of 2008. So clearly his health was impacted. Everyone continues to follow every picture that's released to see whether his left side especially is suffering from the after effects of a stroke. He has diabetes, he has other health problems. So if you just sort of use insurance actuarial tables, he's probably not going to last.